Living in Virginia, you're in the fast lane on the information superhighway. We've invested $3 billion in Virginia's broadband network to give you one of the fastest internet connection speeds in the world, so you can build relationships, bring new business to our state, and meet the future of education. It's amazing what we can do together. Visit vcta.com to learn how broadband connects the Commonwealth.
From the General Assembly and the City of Richmond, I'm Woody Evans for Cable Reports, brought to you by the Virginia Cable Telecommunications Association and Cox Communications, connecting Virginians to their government. We're pleased to have Delegate Chris Peace with us today. Welcome.
Thank you. Appreciate you having me.
I think you still chair General Laws. We'll talk about what that committee does in a moment, but also you are the subcommittee chair on appropriations for elementary and secondary education, I believe.
That is correct.
And you're still a budget conferee?
I was last year and hope to be again this year. They haven't appointed those at this point. We do the budget on Thursday of crossover week.
And we're here on crossover week, one day thereafter. In your opinion, how have things gone?
Well, I always feel that the House operates with great efficiency. We were able to dispatch our bills yesterday. It was on Tuesday. We were at an 11-hour session Monday, hearing and debating and amending legislation on the floor. But I'm very pleased, especially with our House Republican caucus and the measures we've been able to advance.
Talk to us a little bit about the full committee that you chair, General Laws. I mean, I guess everything gets dumped into there that people don't know where to put, so to speak.
I suppose. It is the House's oldest committee, so it's a really historic committee, a real pleasure to serve and chair. We consider issues like FOIA, procurement.
Freedom of Information Act.
That's right. That's how citizens can get information about their government, transparency. Procurement issues, how citizens and small businesses do business with the government. We also see issues related to ABC and gaming and housing, among others. So we do have a general set of issues, but it's very interesting, and we see a lot of unusual bills from time to time.
Well, gaming has been part of the debate for the last few weeks around here. Where does that stand in terms of casinos?
Yeah, I have a great question. So I represent New Kent County, the home of Colonial Downs. And in the last 12 months, we've been able to put forward legislation that has led to the reopening of Colonial Downs, which has been closed for 4 years. When it reopens, it at a minimum provide at least $400,000 to $500,000 to our county for schools and other priorities. So it's really exciting to see Colonial Downs reopen this year with the first races in August. We've seen come forward this session more requests for casino-style gaming. We have a horse track in Colonial Downs, and we have off-track betting sites throughout the Commonwealth, but we do not have casino gaming. We have fantasy sports, we have the lottery, charitable gaming in the Commonwealth, but there are a number of people throughout the state that want to see casino-style gaming. So we've seen bills on those subjects. We've also seen bills to implement the United States Supreme Court decision on sports books. I believe that we need to have a year-long study to see what would be the most appropriate framework, if at all. How do we maximize revenues and also protect the public and the public interest and social concerns that people have? So I've put forward a commission bill to establish a 15-member study commission that would report back November 1st. That has passed the House.
And you mentioned the Freedom of Information Act. I think there's been a move to open up the records of the governor's office, whoever that governor may be, in the future or in the past.
Right. I believe it's 1 year after leaving office, then those records shall be available. Our majority leader, Todd Gilbert, carried that legislation. We had that bill in our General Laws Committee, and that has also passed the House.
Tell us what's been going on the subcommittee and the full committee that you chair in terms of elementary and secondary education.
Well, it's an honor to be on the Appropriations Committee in the House. We design the budget and prioritize the spending, and as many people would say, the state budget reflects Virginia's priorities, and there's probably no greater issue, no greater priority than our school children, our kids, our future, how we determine the investments in our secondary and our K-12 system. Our budget put forward will put more money for teacher salaries. We had 3% in the first year of the budget. We're moving that and increasing it to 5% of the state share for teacher pay raise over the biennium. We've also invested more dollars for school counselors. This is an issue that's been raised to us through our Speaker's Select Committee on School Safety. School counselors are on the front lines and can do a lot of work in prevention, which can also curb school disciplinary issues or other concerns at the school in the future. We're also looking to raise the amount of money we return and supplemental lottery dollars to localities to 45%. This will give additional flexibility to localities to hire testing coordinators or other things that they may deem important for their locality. Not every school system is created equal in the sense we have rural schools that may not be as affluent as schools in Northern Virginia, and we have to be mindful of all the various needs.
What about the ratio between teachers and their pupils?
Well, we're always looking at class sizes. We also have measures related to school construction and maintenance. You know, that's been an issue that was raised by the city of Richmond. We're just looking to have as much money going back in strategic ways to our school systems to benefit teachers, educators, but also our children.
You mentioned counselors. I understand there's some legislation that would require a school counselor to spend 80% of their time actually counseling students.
And I believe that's welcomed by school counselors. Many times they're spending their efforts on testing coordination and career readiness, but we really want them to be in their sweet spot, in their wheelhouse, with helping children with their behavioral or emotional needs.
What about nurses, making sure that school districts have enough nurses on hand?
All of these questions are things we're looking at. I don't know if we want to go down the road of mandating those types of things, because unless we put the money with it, then it's going to be something the localities will have to pick up.
And I guess the same would apply to a school psychologist, for example.
Right. We've had suggestions for family and marriage therapists and other things as well. And so I think we want to make sure the localities have flexibility. That's why that lottery dollar increase is going to be so helpful.
So that lottery dollar increase will allow them to not only maybe hire more support staff, but also come up with their match in terms of the raise for teachers.
Right, so these are direct dollars. There's no match required to draw it down from the state, and it's without strings attached, so the total flexibility.
And school resource officers, I take it there's a move to either increase the number of school resource officers as well?
So we're adding millions of new dollars for school security equipment grants, as well as for school resource officers, as well as requiring that they have the appropriate training. You know, one of the things we heard throughout the year last year was school resource officers, their presence can be a benefit in terms of safety, but they can also be an effect on the climate in certain jurisdictions. And so we want to make sure they are trained appropriately, that they're enforcing laws and not school codes of conduct.
Now, how does the budget that the House recently passed differ from that in the Senate and differ from what the governor had suggested?
Well, one of the things the House did was we stripped out all of the unanticipated revenue that the governor was banking on, the tax increases that the governor has proposed by not giving all of the money back to the people from the Trump Tax Cut and Reform Act from December of 2017. And we want to start basically from a base budget. So none of the monies that we're sending to localities for schools, for example, is based on that unanticipated revenue. We have tax conformity legislation moving forward, as well as a separate bill that I'm a chief co-patron of that would increase the standard deduction and address other issues in terms of tax reform to ultimately give over $1 billion back to the taxpayer to whom it rightfully belongs. This is unanticipated revenue the state would be getting essentially as a windfall because of the Trump tax cut.
Now, did some of that unanticipated revenue also include potential revenue based upon the Supreme Court decision in the Wayfair case?
So there's also legislation moving forward basically to codify elements of that decision, and we already are seeing those types of companies that didn't have a physical nexus to Virginia beginning to collect and remit sales tax the way bricks and mortar retailers would. We've heard for a long time, and a lot of people were very pleased by the U.S. Supreme Court decision in Wayfair, that bricks and mortar, small business, mom and pops were at a competitive disadvantage. Many times people would go in, they try on shoes, see if they like them, and then walk out the door without making a purchase, only to go on to Amazon to order those shoes and have them sent to their home. That's a real concern for those who are small businesses and employ people in our communities.
Now, what's the extent of the potential revenue generation as a result of that decision?
Well, we don't know exactly yet, and so we're not changing any of the formulas that would flow from that sales tax, things like roads in particular. So we didn't want to get into opening Pandora's box and having all of those various interest groups fight over who and where those dollars should go. The sales tax that would be collected and remitted would flow through the normal channels.
So take us through the difference between the Tax and Jobs Act and what is currently in the code of the state of Virginia in terms of needed changes.
Well, the biggest thing right now is that we're in tax filing season, and Virginia Tax Department can't process tax returns until we get conformity done. And one of the issues with conformity that we want to see happen sooner than later, and we're disappointed that our friends on the other side of the aisle blocked the emergency provision of that act that would allow those things to take place now and move forward, is that it's conforming the language of the bill, but without adjusting rates. That's why people would pay more. And so we're looking at trying to solve that problem and get money back to the people. I filed a bill that has been incorporated in part into the Delegate Hugo, a bill that I'm a chief co-patron of that increases standard deductions, that deals with things along those lines. I'd also ask that we look at reducing the corporate tax rate from 6%, step down to 5%. Just about less than 30 days ago, North Carolina lowered their corporate tax to 2.5%. So if we want to remain competitive in terms of attracting businesses, then I think we need to be looking at not just the individual and family side, but also the corporate side of the tax ledger.
So some of those fundamental changes included, for example, the definition of adjusted gross income, as I understand it.
Right. And so there would be more monies, more taxable income if we don't adjust the rates and conform and then have the bill, the separate bill, moving forward to allow people to still do a standard deduction and increase that.
And as you indicated, there is a fairly large gulf between what the standard deduction is at the federal level versus what it currently is at the state level.
Yeah, I had proposed to just double it. That would have been, I think, the ideal. But you know, politics is the art of the possible. And so we're still in a process, also then negotiating with our Senate counterparts and being very different from where the governor started with the fully refundable provisions that he put forward.
That's on the earned income tax credit.
The earned income tax credit, right.
And in terms of state and local taxes, what's likely to happen with that, assuming that Virginia will allow itemized deductions?
Well, the CPAs want us to be done with all of this very soon, and so do the taxpayers. And I'm optimistic about our prospects for getting it done now. 3 weeks left in session. We need to take care of this business as soon as possible.
I know you have a bill in terms of what happens if I'm approaching a stationary vehicle,
right,
on the highways and byways of the state of Virginia. Why is that important?
It's really important. We've seen too often people distracted driving, not paying attention, and not giving courtesy to those who are serving us. A day in December, we had 4 state troopers rear-ended from distracted drivers, people not moving over while they were assisting motorists. The most tragic story was in Hanover, where we lost a firefighter who was assisting a motorist during Hurricane Michael. It was a real loss to our community. Brad Clark was a hero among us. His widow and his extended family have been advocates ever since for enhancing the penalties for the move over requirements that we already have. People have to move over when they see the flashing red, blue, or even amber lights from VDOT workers that are on the side of the highway, tow truck drivers. People should always give way if it's safe to do or slow down. And right now, under current law, the first offense is a $250 traffic fine. The second offense is reckless driving. My argument is, why isn't it reckless all the time? If we said it's on the second time, how is doing it twice more reckless than doing it once? This truck driver who killed Brad Clark did it once. We can't get Brad back. But his memory, and we're honoring his memory by pushing this legislation forward. Unanimous support in the House. We also have a license plate that honors him and firefighters and our first responders, encouraging people to move over. And the monies will go towards a foundation that will help first responders in crisis. So we're very happy about the progress so far. We really hope our Senate counterparts see the wisdom in basically truing up the existing law, saying that failure to move over or slow down in a safe manner is reckless regardless of when you do it.
Now, were you able to get the number of applications needed for that license
plate? We did.
Plate?
Yeah, you have to have 450 prepaid applications before the bill can be heard. And we worked really hard with a lot of local folks, a gentleman named James Munsey, Melanie Clark, Jonathan Clark, Brad's brother, many others in the community helped us, and we got the number we needed. So we're very happy about that.
Well, congratulations on that effort.
Yeah.
Now, there have been numerous attempts, for example, to criminalize the use of handheld communications devices while driving. And I know that's been part of the debate this year as well. Where is that now?
Yeah, so the Senate and the House have passed legislation to prohibit the use of handheld devices. So we're finally getting to the point where many other states and localities, and I think Washington, D.C., already has had that in place. And this will really help, I think, our traveling public and motorists. We've just seen anecdotally way too many incidences that would be preventable but for distracted driving. The move over is one example. But every day you see folks driving down the street, weaving, you know, driving slowly, thinking that they're being safe, and it's just not.
Let's talk a little bit about economic development. There was the Amazon announcement recently. Just want to know how your jurisdictions are doing in terms of economic development, and to what extent will the Amazon announcement have an impact throughout the Commonwealth, and in particular your district?
That's a complicated question, I'll say. I think people in our area are rightly skeptical of big deals like this. I actually voted against the legislation that would help to put that into place. I believe the governor signed those bills yesterday, at least by report. It's not that I'm against Amazon, and it's not that the people in our area don't use Amazon. I think the last Christmas season would be proof positive that people, you know, love that service that is provided. But I think we need to look at our small businesses and support them as much or more. Our local businesses need our help as well. One of the things that would really help small business in our area is the deployment of broadband. That's a major issue for us. Delegate Yancey had a bill on broadband for rural areas that I supported yesterday. We're also working in career and technical education, workforce development. Every year, I think almost I've carried a bill to try to help our career and technical education system. And this year, we're allowing people who do apprenticeships and internships to use that time towards the hours required for their graduation. Just another way we can get kids into a classroom setting that is not in the classroom, where they're actually getting training on the ground that would help them towards their certifications and the work that they would do going forward.
What about dual enrollments in high schools?
Oh, that's a big thing. We love that. Hanover's doing it. You know, kids are able to save a lot of money as well if they go on to a two-year AA program or even four-year by having those additional credits from the get-go. AP was sort of what we had when I was growing up. There's the International Baccalaureate program as well, but dual enrollment, I think, is a great thing for families as well to save money. if their children are going to go on to a 2 or 4 year degree.
So what are we doing in order to keep pace in terms of funding the community colleges around the state?
Yeah, that, you know, that's an excellent question. You'd have to ask Delegate Nick Rush that. He chairs higher education. But I know the community colleges are doing a lot in workforce development. We created a grant program, I believe it was about a year and a half ago, that was already fully subscribed. And so we're working to kind of continue to replenish that for, you know, workforce development issues.
Now, what about in your district in particular? I know you have a lot of tourist attractions. You've got 3 great golf courses there, if my memory serves me correctly. But I take it there's some other amenities there to attract people?
Well, absolutely. And, you know, we're near Kings Dominion as well. That's in Hanover County. We've got a lot of golf courses. We have a lot of wineries. You know, a lot of people love doing that. They think of Albemarle and Charlottesville, but I'd encourage them to come to New Kent and visit the many wineries and attractions we have. And Colonial Downs, again, reopening will be a huge benefit for our area.
Election law has been in the headlines, and I think you have a proposal dealing with changing the primary date in June.
Right. I'm a co-patron of that legislation Delegate Landis has put forward. This is also a recommendation from our Select Committee on School Safety. Delegate Fowler in Hanover carried the bill a couple years ago, but it failed on the floor. What our purpose is to say if there's going to be an election held, we also don't want it during the school year. So this is disruptive to the classroom, to those that are you know, in our school system at the time. Plus, it's bringing a lot of people to the school that may not have the best of purposes. So it serves two, I think, good causes. One, school safety, but also the administration of education locally.
What were some of the other recommendations that came out of that committee, especially given the gun violence that we've seen over the past few years?
Right. I chaired the subcommittee on prevention and response. And so the training, working to bolster DCJS, which also provides a lot of those training modules for our SROs and for localities. The school counselors is huge. That's going to be a big step forward in terms of prevention. Our view as a House caucus was that we want to stop the problems from happening at the front end. You know, the gun violence and those issues that take place as a result of mental health issues, we can solve that problem by addressing the mental health up front. And so that's where our focus was.
Well, let's talk about how you propose to address those kinds of issues. Obviously, our schools have become repositories of everything, so to speak. We expect everything out of them, but these kids are coming to school with these problems. So how do we address that in the first instance?
Well, there's no silver bullet, pardon the pun. I mean, there's no panacea that can address everything perfectly. It's total team and community effort. I'm a family law attorney, and I see a lot of these problems when it gets to the courthouse, when people are filing a CHINS petition trying to get services for families. You know, one of the things that we did in the budget last year with Medicaid expansion helps families access health care, in particular for opiate addiction, for mental health services. And, you know, when you peel the onion, particularly when you see children in court, the child is a product of the environment. And so if we're able to help that environment through stabilization on those issues, mental health, substance use, then we're going to help the whole family. And then in turn, that helps the school system. You know, the school system is getting the input. It's the input that brings those challenges. And so again, an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. If we're helping these families up front, and prevention, we're going to be making a great deal of difference, helping the schools, helping the entire community.
You mentioned a CHINS petition. I take it that means children in need of supervision?
Or services. And services is really the key. And trying to, you know, get the key in the door and open that for services through our local community services boards and with the help of DSS as well.
What about the need for periodic training in terms of evacuations of schools or when a shooter comes into the school, those kinds of things.
We're very blessed. We've got 3 awesome sheriff's offices in Hanover, New Kent, and King William. I know the King and Queen as well as does a great job. And they have active shooter drills, armed intruder drills is I think what they call them. And then they have a manual on safety that they update, and they've got crisis coordinators in each of the school systems. New Kent actually just hired a specialist to supervise all of that. And so I was able to meet with our school systems and our sheriffs during the process last year, learn from them what is happening. We want to take approach, first, do no harm. We want to add and not detract. We don't want to have an unfunded mandate to our localities. If they're doing something well, we want to support that. And I think that's where you saw the recommendations come forward from the select committee.
What about alerting parents about those exercises before they occur?
Well, you know, we don't want to tip off anything. We want people to take these drills seriously. You know, it's sort of like the sky is falling. You know, the more you do it, the more people are aware it's just a drill. Maybe they don't take seriously. We want people to practice and be ready should there be a problem. But again, we're focusing on prevention. We're reducing the likelihood that there are going to be those types of issues in our communities.
You mentioned the training of school resource officers earlier, because there have been some complaints about their tendency to refer kids who were disruptive or who were acting out to prosecutors for juvenile court proceedings.
Yeah, so I think our view is we want to try to keep the child in the school setting as much as possible. We do that for children that have other behavioral, emotional needs through the IEP process.
That's the individual educational plan.
Yes, Woody, you are really good on these issues. There are a lot of acronyms in government, as you know. Yeah, and so it's a fine line. We want to make sure we're appropriately balancing the needs of safety versus the needs of the climate and the children that are there in the school system. You know, none of us believe we should have, barbed wire fences and a prison-like setting. That is absolutely not appropriate for school children, for their school environment. So we want a warm, loving environment and to keep children in the school setting as much as possible.
There's been a lot of talk as a result of court actions over the last few years concerning not only the House of Delegates and the State Senate, but also congressional seats and the need to come up with some type of commission to draw the lines. And I know there are a number of bills. What's happening with that?
Yeah, so Delegate Mark Cole has a constitutional amendment, a proposal that would establish such a commission that would be nonpartisan, if you can ever have that. It would actually remove the governor from the process. We believe that redistricting, in its fundamental sense, is a political exercise, but it's also a legislative prerogative. And so we're working on that legislation now. We don't know what the districts will look like ultimately for this upcoming cycle, the 100 House districts. We have a map that's been put forward by the special master who's appointed by the federal court. We've gone through the ins and outs of that process over the last several years, despite the Justice Department pre-clearing these very same districts. So we're playing the ball where it lies, like they say in golf, and we're going to have a map at some point soon. And everyone is going through their nomination process now and looking towards their elections in either June or November.
Now, that constitutional amendment has to be passed this year. There has to be an intervening election that's passed the following year before it goes to the voters.
And it needs to be the exact same each year. So there can't be changes next year, otherwise that would kill the proposal. So, but that is correct.
And you have a constitutional amendment, I think, that you are pursuing as well.
I had a proposal regarding the Convention of States. You know, many of us have said over the years, referring to the 10th Amendment, that we do have at times a runaway federal government that leads to more and more spending. The folks in my area really want to make sure we rein in government and control spending at all levels.
Thank you, Delegate Chris Peace.
Thank
you,
Woody.
Good to see you. Thank you for watching Cable Reports, brought to you by the Virginia Cable Telecommunications Association and Cox Communications. Until next time, I'm Woody Evans. We'll be right back.